as founder and honorary chair of Kampala Bantu, he has embodied the spirit of Hesed and Tzedakah in an astounding and impactful way over the last 5 decades. It's my privilege to invite her to share her closing keynote with us.
Hi everyone. Yes, thank you. Can you hear me?
Yes.
I think I'll also do what everybody did. Don't stand in early on me. Stand up. Can you hear me now?
Yes.
Well, sort of I'm the last runner in the lap. I'm sure you're very tired. So I hope sort of this will be satisfying and not a too tiring close to the evening. Thank you very much. I'm really honored, especially Lynn, that you're here. Thank you so much for rushing back. I know you did. Thank you very much, Brian, for thinking of me. To be in a group of young, vibrant people like yourself is just amazing for me. It's a long time since I've been in such stimulating company, and I really mean it. So thank you for this wonderful opportunity. I'll take it with me for a long time. A guy called me and he asked me if I'd address this conference. I sort of said yes, and then I thought to myself when I put the phone down, I don't know if I'm the appropriate person to speak to young people like yourself, because I tend to overstep my boundaries, I tend to say it as it is, and what am I coming up to Johannesburg to ruffle the feathers? Young people. There are others up here who do it equally well. So, and then I asked him again, what do you want me to say? What do you want me to do? And he said, say something inspiring, say something that has a message, and say something that might be of value to young, vibrant, entrepreneurial change makers. And I thought about him, what can I say to you? Here I am, 70, you understand the English voice go out, which means overworked, not underfed, and here I face you with, from my heart, a message. And I'd like to start it by saying, I started considering who I am. Who am I? Well, first and foremost, and proudly, I am a Jewish woman. Where do I come from? I have a mixed parentage, one, a Lithuanian father who came here at the age of 14, who lived on the streets in Cape Town. He escaped being taken into the Russian army because in those days they took the young men, put them in the front to be cannon fodder. And he was the only son then, left at home, and they decided that they, you know, the girls who were left at home gave him a feather bed and a copper pot and a black bread. And they told him to get to the boats and to get to Africa. And he landed here without the language and with no literacy for what he needed to do the job, and he lived on the streets. And lucky for him, there was one man who saw this group of young boys who got together. A judge, advocate surgeon. He found these children, he brought them into their house, his house in the back room though, and he taught them to speak English and he taught them to read and write. And he got that step up, he got that opportunity. And then he got the cheapest land he could find in a place that was allocated for people of color. And we moved and lived in Grassy Park, which was somewhere near Newsonville, but in a very distant rural area in those days. My mother, on the other hand, came from England. her father was in prison as a conscientious objector. He would not kill for that. He was put to prison and he died in prison because I believe we later got all the love letters that came from him from the prison, which I have today, explaining the conditions and the harshness, and they were harsher with him than other prisoners because he wouldn't eat meat and he would kill. And he said she never saw him again. And my story isn't different. You all dig down deep into yourselves from what you all have as your ancestry. So we come from not the most sort of well-heeled distant past. But if we look at who we are today and the history of where we are as Jewish people, I think we can feel really proud. Proud why? Because we have with us a heritage that is quite amazing. Because my father didn't make it big, but by the time he died, somehow we found that he had accumulated. He never told us till we died, we found the properties. And he saved up and bought this little piece of land. The property was sort of hidden from the family. See, he was always scared that something would happen and he had nothing. But the rest of the Jewish community are an amazing community if you look at it. Look how everybody that came here didn't come in the manner that others here today immigrate with lots of money and all the furnishings, all the education and a skill and going where they know they're going in most cases and having themselves already set up where they go. They came with nothing. They were not really that comfortable when they came in here or accepted or assisted that much, but they made it. They made it for themselves, but they didn't make it for themselves. They made it for us, their families. They gave us everything they didn't have. But they did much more than that. I think for me, my greatest pride as a Jewish woman, when I'm questioned, especially within the communities, basically also to stimulate the communities that I work in, is to tell them what our Jewish people have done. First of all, from the first day I stepped in the townships, I was questioned, what am I doing there? What is my motivation? Who am I? And it's always that I'm a Jewish woman. This is the life. I've been practicing in every way I can, everything that my Judaism says to me, because this is what Jews do. And I think, if I may say, for a contribution to South Africa, the other things that have gone around me are not as valuable as the understanding of who we are as our Jewish community, because it's right throughout South Africa. And it's caused different type of relationship, understanding, and acknowledgement of who we are as Jews. And if I can advise on that whatever we do with people who aren't culturally the same as us in our religion and in our lifestyle, is whatever we do, not to want to put it in the newspapers or market ourselves. The only marketing we need is to carry out what it is we do and to say, this is what we do as Jewish people, because that's how we will build our future for our children, and it is most important. But what I was also meaning to say was, I try to get across to everyone the wonder of what the Jewish people created. There are three things. First of all, I think they have been very instrumental in creating the economic well-being and power of South Africa. Their industriousness, their creativeness, their sacrifice. Most places developed in the rural areas, all the hotels, all the smoke shops, were done by Jews. They opened up the country in those days. They were brave enough. They went and they sought out how to eke out a living, because they didn't have many. And then, when we think of the struggle, we can stand up very proud. Our Jewish forefathers and ancestors in an individual capacity, not in a collective, but in an individual capacity, stood up to be counted. And we should never forget them. We should salute them for what they did, because they have allowed us the comfort that we have and the comfort going forward for our children. And the third thing that I feel very proud of is think of ourselves as Jewish people so comfortable, because we have every institution that might be required by our people. We have the Hebrew Kedisha here doing an amazing job. We have in Cape Town, the Glendales, the old aged home. We have our Jewish day schools. Nobody did it for us. We did it. Our parents, our forefathers did it for us. And it's such a lovely feeling. It makes us feel, I have a great pride in it, and I often talk about it. And I say in the communities when, you know, I'm told, oh, we don't have this. I go into communities that I haven't worked, and, you know, I get tested by it. And I said, don't think that our forefathers landed with loads of money. They had nothing. They didn't have the language either. And in some cases, they had similar policies that were directed against us in some stages, not anything like apartheid, but they battled through and they saw to their people. Now let's get up and do something about using your people, people that you need in your communities. And you do it, I'll stand behind you. So why am I giving you the history you know so well? Why am I hugging you and saying all this to you? Because now comes, you know, it's like the scorpion, now comes the tale that I want to present to you. I think this goes without saying, as our Jewish, as the Jewish people we are, our first and foremost duty is to our own. And we must never forget that we are here always to look after our own. Because if we don't look after our own, our Jewish people are in trouble. But there's another element to looking after our own. If we don't look after others as well, we're actually not looking after our own, because we're not creating a comfortable country that we leave behind as our legacy for our children. And that's our duty as well. And in doing so, I want to give you a story, and I want to tell you how I think, how, it's not that I'm trying to tell you what I do, because I don't do it well, but it's something that's part of my everyday living. And maybe I can give you the reason. When I started working in the townships, I was 21. I didn't understand what I was. I was naive, I was stupid. I didn't know what I was doing, but I did know all the trouble I was getting. And I was getting flapped around all over the place in police vans. It wasn't very comfortable. It wasn't very nice. And on top of it, I had parents who never understood. And unfortunately, my father died before he was able to understand that there was some value to what I was doing. And he always said that I was maybe one of his clever children. I wasn't. But I was one of his clever children who became a criminal. So, just sort of to share that with you. But after getting into trouble with all the Rabbonim and with the Jewish establishment of those days, and being told that I brought disgrace on our Jewish community and that I must stop what I was doing because it would bring profile, and we must understand the context. That in those days, the Jewish people were just trying to get comfortable here, to establish themselves. So there is a little bit of an excuse, or a little bit of pardoning on that score. But for myself, it was very difficult because I actually hadn't formulated my sense of self. I didn't know who I was, where I was going, what was right. I started doubting what I was doing. And in the end, the only way I could make peace with myself after my last brush with a really, really abusive rabbi threw me out of the synagogue and said something very nasty. It was a about cursing the Jewish people and all sorts of ugly things to me. I decided I would not pray. I would not. There's nothing I have to say to God. All I have to do is do it. And each day by doing every single movement, every single thing I do, that would be my prayer. And that would be my spiritual communion or communication with my God. And that's how I live as a Jewish woman. I examine it daily, I look at it, and I think, would this be of value as a Jewish woman? Taking myself forward. So I'll give you one example of now of what I'd like to say to you and ask you to forgive me before you hear it for what I'm going to say to you. I think we have to move forward in honor of all that our parents did to sacrifice themselves for us. We have to take forward the legacy and the one sacrifice in their honor. And we have to, this is what I would say, we have to look a little further than ourselves in our world, even a little further than the projects and the programs. For me, it's not about becoming a teacher, that's just on the side. But in every person that I meet in special circumstances, I try to consider what would be the best carrying the torch that I'm carrying. And that is, I'll give you an example. So I go to see my accountants. So I'm driving Michael's 4x4, which I rent. So I get into the parking garage, and there's that much for a car that big to park in. And a very nice gentleman comes up, and you can see this old girl's not doing well. He takes me in, and he takes me out, and he moves me around, and he waves from this side. And I'm schwitzing, and eventually I get out the car, and I go up to him to thank him. And I look into the most amazing man's face. And I said to him, thank you. For taking the trouble. Because if I would have bunged up this car, I would have gone into trouble when I got home. And he spoke to me so beautifully. And I had a couple of minutes, I was early, and I started to talk to him. And it turned out that he was from the Congo, and that he was escaping war. And I checked it out afterwards in every way. And that he was a professor of pharmacology. And his wife had been busy with her doctorate in education. He was a car guard in the basement of this parking garage. I got it checked out, and all it took from me was one phone call for the husband and one phone call for the wife. Today, he's lecturing at UCT, he's running a laboratory, and she is the choice teacher in a Khayelitsha school teaching English. And what I'm saying, not me, I phoned my professor friend, because we've all got professor friends, we've got them everywhere. We've got a connection everywhere. And when I did it for my father, because I remember somebody did it for me. And so we've got to look back. What happened to our parents? What happened to others? To our ancestors? And we've got to carry our Jewish torch, just that little thing. And if each of us do this, and we pass it on to the next person, we pass it on to the next person, we can set up a way. But it must be done in a Jewish voice. Because he asked me, why have you done this for me? Because I went for lunch with him. And he said, why did you do it for me? I said, because I'm Jewish. He said, I don't know too much about the Jews, tell me. And here is a professor, an ex-professor, he has the qualification, and he didn't know too much about the Jewish people. And I told him, and I said, this is how we live, this is what we do. And I'm sure he'll pass it on, but that's what you're called. And another thing is, I'm not talking about just immigrant people, I'm talking about any person that you see. We were now in, a little while ago, I went to Klet, and a certain waiter came up to us, and he served us absolutely beautifully. He just spoke beautifully. He had the most beautiful English and he spoke respectfully. And after the meal, I asked him if he was permitted to talk to me because he was on duty. He said no, and so we made a time for after duty. And at the usual mark, he said, "Well, you're starting your nonsense again. Why don't you leave him alone? He doesn't need your nonsense. What are you doing when you're pushing him?" So I met this young man, and he had a story that in his matricula, both his parents died of AIDS, and he his matricula, etc., etc. So he was a waiter, but I could see he had potential. So it was again saying to him, because I think we're connected, we have knowledge, we know how to do it. We've got an isolated community that's all around us. All I did was to say to him, "Do you know about the EBT colleges? Do you know you can complete your matric and you can continue your work because there's this, this, this?" And he said, "No." And he said, "How do I get this?" So I said, all it was one little trip. I phoned up, I found out where the EBT college was, which was round the corner from the Beacon Isle Hotel. Absolutely could have walked there. Pitched him, took him there, introduced him to the principal of the EBT college. He's now enrolled. He'll do his matric. Look out further. And that's my message, that I'm not telling you to turn the world upside down. I'm telling you that I think we are have great power in our hands. I think we are highly skilled. I think we have great knowledge and we are so connected. We can start the same type of Arab Spring in terms of building into whose eyes, and we see there's possibility, and we can open doors for them, and we can help them, and we can do it in an anonymous way, and move off, and give them the space to, but do it as who we are, as Jewish people, in the memory, and in the tribute to our ancestors. And I hope I haven't told you to do what you should be doing, or what you're not happy to do, but that's what I thought. How can I, if we each do 50 people a year, and we get 50 friends to do another 50 a year. What we can do? We can spread like wildfire.
Before you sit down, I have a few questions. The first question, and I'm going to put on a different hat for just a moment, and that is the hat that I think I said earlier, that our foundation gives 75% of what it gives away to Jewish charities. That's written in stone as guidelines for my children and my grandchildren. And the 25% that doesn't has improved life in Oklahoma. But I want to ask you two questions. The first is that, and I just came from hearing Jill, I look at two amazing, dynamic women that have made such a difference in this country. And both of you are very proud of being Jewish. But have you instilled in some people of color here what we are working on doing in America, where those people who have means, and I have to go to though, they're not Brad Pitt and Angelina Jolie and Michael Jordan and people, and make them as responsible for their own as we are for our own. And that's my first question to you. And then secondly, I have to look at the 17,000 young people that were left home through March that did not go on Birthright because there wasn't Jewish money to send Jewish kids around the world to Israel, wanted to go to their homeland. So when I look at what both you and Jill have done, I take off my hat and I am in awe, because you have problems here that we don't have, but I have worked very diligently in Oklahoma to bring education to those less fortunate in Oklahoma, and worked on earned income tax and all kinds of programs. So I think that we have to look at this, and I'm very blessed that I can do both. I can give and make a difference in the non-Jewish world in Oklahoma, and I can make a longest difference in the Jewish world around the world. And I want to know how we can encourage others who look like me, not quite one with the weight problem, but a man to care enough, as you talked about what you said, make a phone call, get somebody out of that parking garage, but still make sure that that kid goes on birthright. So this is something that's vitally important to me, and then how you take some of your soccer stars of color and some of these, or football or whatever they're called, musicians who made a lot of money, and get them to want to give back to this country. Like we
the people that I've tried to influence and I think have worked, I don't know soccer stars. I don't know soccer. I don't know soccer. Okay? any of them big deals. But what has worked is taking leaders of the community, and it's quite unbelievably amazing. I think Charles, you can test for this in the other Cape Town people. You have, and Johannesburg people that I'm working with, it's changing the mindset of entitlement to active responsibility. And that's a very big thing, and that's why I come this world. Because we don't own anything. A project, an initiative, succeeds, it's because the community have done it, and the leadership have backed it. And if it fails, you may fail. They can't say things to us. And that's why it's spread like wildfire, because everybody owns it, and everybody understands that they want a better life, and it's up to them to create a better life for themselves, to look properly. And if they don't, they just drop out, and we don't include them in the privilege of being part of who we are. But the big deal, I don't know. So, and I don't think I will be getting to it.